watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Everyone, and welcome to Bio 190. I am Kira Mathis, the instructor for the class. Hopefully everybody knows that by now. Today we have Sandy Troutwine with us, so thanks for being here today.
Yeah,
so her and I have been doing this class, I think, for the last 3 years.
Yeah,
I think the last 3 years, although she's done this class many times before. So we're really excited to have her. Today for session 6, we are now transitioning from all of the ecosystems and different habitats into the animals. So today we are going to be discussing echinoderms and arthropods. But what I would like to do before we get started with that is just remind everybody that your extra credit lab is due tonight. Do not email me your extra credit lab. It needs to be uploaded via the extra credit tab on Blackboard. Make sure it's in a Word document or rich text format, because if it's not, I can't open it. If I can't open it, you won't get credit. So make sure you follow the instructions. You've had plenty of time to email me with questions, so hopefully if you procrastinated, you get it right the first time. Also, don't forget, discussion board will open up after class. That'll close next Tuesday before class starts. Same thing with the quiz. And as usual, you want to get your 2 participation points today, either by calling or emailing in, or you can do so via the participation tab after the class, or even during the class is fine. Make sure you do it correctly. Do not put it in the comments. You'll notice that if you've been putting it in the comments, you've been warned that you won't get credit starting after last week. So if you don't put it in the correct submission where it says write, I think it says write submission, if you try and enter it in the comments, you're not going to get credit for it. So make sure you're following instructions to get your points. Thanks for all your emails. You guys have been emailing in with questions about the assignments and such, so I'm here for you. If you have questions and you want to jump on the phone, we can always set up a phone appointment or a Skype session, so make sure you utilize that. Next week, your field trip paper is due by 11:55 next Tuesday night, unless you have set up a different arrangement with me, or if your sponsor has set up a different arrangement with me. Monarch High School, normally you guys have a little bit of a different scenario because of your field trip. So you guys will have a different due date depending. So unless you have set something up with me specifically, then you are gonna have a paper due next Tuesday. All right, so with that, again, Sandy, thank you for joining us today. So as we always like to do when we have guests, we'll have you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about what you do and some of your background and all that fun stuff.
Okay. Well, thanks again for having me. My name is Sandy Troutwine, of course. I'm the curator of fish and invertebrates at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I've held that position there for almost 19 years now, so about a year and a half before the aquarium actually opened. And my primary function at the aquarium is to help design exhibits, all of the fish and invertebrate exhibits. There is another curator, of course, that helps with the bird and mammal exhibits, but I help to design them, maybe help with the theming of them, choosing which animals go into each of these different exhibits, and then supervising a staff of about 20 folks that help to maintain our fish and invertebrate collection. So I also have a PhD from UCLA, and my background has always been more in tropical biology, and for my PhD studying crustaceans. So I'm happy to be here today.
Awesome, and I always learn so much every time you're here.
Oh,
so
thank you.
I've got tons to learn from you, so I always get excited. All right, so we're gonna jump into our content for today. So the class is gonna be broken up into 2 different phylums. So we're gonna start our first half of class with echinoderms that have nothing to do with the second half of our animals today, which are the arthropods. But when we talk about echinoderms, we basically mean the spiny skinned animals, right?
That's correct, that's exactly what it means.
So what kind of animals are we talking about here then?
Urchins, sea stars, sea cucumbers. These are the primary players in the echinoderm group.
And we talked a little bit about them when we were talking about like the rocky shore, the rocky intertidal. So you can see that that's one of the reasons that we do all of the habitats and ecosystems first. And now we're going to talk about the animals that live in those that live essentially in those habitats. So there are some conditions that make an echinoderm, right? So what are some of those things?
Well, some of the primary characteristics include radial symmetry, an endoskeleton, a water vascular system, and a means of locomotion using tube feet. So basically, to start, they are radially symmetrical, which means that you can turn them any way and they're basically the same, sort of like a wheel in a mm-hmm. way that it's radial and it's spread out like that.
Right.
So they really don't have a head or a foot or a posterior or dorsal end, but more just an oral and an aboral end.
Hmm.
And that's the mouth is generally on the bottom. I think of a sea star, the mouth is underneath there, and then the aboral end is on the top of it. And that's the same for the urchins as well, but not for sea cucumbers. They are bilateral.
Right.
Bilateral.
Can we bring up a picture of the echinoderms, please? So just so you can get an idea, if we can take a look at those, we'll go full screen. So just reiterating what you were saying, basically like if I were to cut this any which way, right, it's going to essentially kind of look the same. Same thing, like I could cut this into a million little pieces, and each piece is going to essentially look the same. Now, except for the sea cucumber, can we pull up a picture of the sea cucumber? That's the third picture. There we go. Now, bilateral, you said like we would essentially cut these in half, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So if you cut that in half, it's going to look the same. That's just like a human, right?
Exactly.
We're mirrored to each other.
Right.
Now, endoskeleton, what is that about?
Well, it's an endoskeleton just like ours, which means the skeleton is on the inside, and then they have a thin layer of tissue on the outside. And sometimes that tissue on the outside is kind of bumpy and has some external structures to it, and that's why they call it spiny skin.
Spiny skin, very good. We have a giant spined sea star, so that should be picture number 4. And we really get a good look at that spine. Now, obviously, the sea urchin has, like, textbook spiny skin.
Right.
But then the sea stars have too. Can we go this full screen, please, so we can just take a look? There you go. So all these little things here are little spikes, essentially.
Yep.
All right. And water vascular system, this is unique to echinoderms, right?
Yes, it is. It's a very unique system that only these animals have, and they generally use it not only to move using tube feet, but also to breathe and to exchange other things through their tissue. So they're very important, this water vascular system.
So if we were, can we pull this full screen? This is basically, if we were to strip the top layers off, this is kind of like, now this has nothing to do with blood, but this is kind of like our vascular system. Like we have veins and arteries that move stuff around. Now this is just moving water around, you said, right?
Exactly. So these are just water-filled canals with muscular extension, and they end in tube feet, and they expand and contract in order to allow the sea star or the urchin to move.
And we have a pretty cool video of that. We'll get to that in just a second. But let's talk on about their locomotion. So the tube feet, you said, it's almost like they're little suction cups that kind of move along and help, but that's created by water pressure.
That's correct.
That's brought into that water vascular system.
That's correct. And when the water is sort of sucked back from those tube feet from the ending, then it creates a contraction and a suction, and then when the water vascular tube foot is filled with water, then it's released. So in this way, they can keep moving very slowly across the substrate.
I'm trying to think of what we would use. Like if we're like in the shower, we have kind of the suction cups, right?
Yeah.
And it's like if you're, when they're sucking the water away, it's like, you know, we feel that suction, like if you're suctioning something to the,
yeah,
the shower or whatever. Okay, so we have a really cool video that shows tube feet and how they're being utilized to move. There shouldn't be any sound with this, so we can just talk over it.
Okay.
If we want to explain. So if we can pull that first video up. There we go.
Oh, cool. Yeah, so you can see it's very slowly how they're moving, but as that water-filled canal is the water is expanded and contracted, they can release and attach these tube feet. And actually, some sea stars are very quick. There are some large sunflower sea stars that can move pretty quickly across the seafloor.
I'm always surprised at how fast they move. I mean, just even, you know, when I'm working the touch pools and I'm watching them move, you're like, if you stop and look, you're like, oh yeah, he's totally booking it across the touch pool there. I mean, but you have to be looking for it. But it's not like, you know, it takes them days or whatever to cross a pool. They can go pretty good.
And they're actually quite strong enough, and we'll get into it later about digestion, but strong enough to actually open up a like a bivalve,
like a mussel or a clam. Yeah, we have a really awesome video later to show that as well. Now, how many tube feet do sea stars have? That probably ranges, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I actually don't even have a number.
I have no idea.
It's like, I mean, because I think about like bat stars, right? And bat stars have less than, say, like an okra star. Okra star probably have thousands.
So. Yeah, I would think so.
Yeah, I don't know. I just was thinking about how much the different species vary in tube feet.
Yeah.
All right, we can bring it back now that our sea star is almost out of the view there. Now, as far as ecology and range, there's about 6,000 species, right, that are mm-hmm. marine. And do they just live in like the rocky intertidal, or do they live all over?
Though they can live all over, but they are exclusively marine. So you won't find them in freshwater or like semi-terrestrial habitats, but they're exclusively marine. You can find them from sandy to rocky substrate everywhere.
And what about cold water, hot water?
Both. Cold water and hot water, yeah.
Warm and cold.
They're found everywhere.
Yeah, this is a good picture. This is an intertidal here. If we can go full screen, you can see there's just a bunch
beautiful.
Going on there.
Yeah.
So, all right, so we're going to jump in and talk a little bit more specifically about different types of echinoderms. So we mentioned sea stars, sea urchins, sand dollars, sea cucumbers. These are all examples. So let's start with sea stars. Now, they have a very unique way of eating, and they range in the things that they eat, right? Like they'll eat lots of meat and
They're mostly carnivorous, meaning they're meat eaters, but they'll also feed on things like sponges, bryozoans, and mollusks. There are some that are also filter feeders. They'll actually filter things out of the water, or they can be scavengers or even specialized feeders like the crown of thorn sea star, which causes so much damage on live coral.
Right, yes. Mackenzie, so it says, yes, Mackenzie, we'll get to the research proposal at the end of the class today so I can bring it up. I'm going to try and get it going on the computer here. So she was asking about details for the requirements for the research proposal. So yeah, we will be talking about that. All right. Now for the sea stars, they don't have a mouth and teeth. Right?
No.
So they very unique in this way.
Yeah, they do. They actually use their tube feet to sort of create a powerful grip on their prey. And then they actually bring their stomach to their food, which is quite unique. They can bring their stomach into the food. So imagine that a sea star climbs over a clam. And the clam is very strong, of course. It doesn't want to be eaten, but with the grip of the tube feet, the sea star can actually break that open a little bit just along the edge, and then it can push its stomach into the clam to start digesting it. So it actually brings its stomach to the food instead of the food to the stomach. And when it puts the stomach into the clam, it releases digestive juices that actually slowly break down the clam.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
I mean, so it's like, yeah, like if we were to eat, right, it would be like if we had a piece of pizza, like our stomachs would come out of our body, digest the pizza, break it all down, kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? Like soak it up, right?
Yeah,
and then they would just like, we would bring our stomachs back into our mouth.
Right,
and
exactly
then back into
it.
A place. So definitely an interesting way of eating. So let's go ahead and take a look. Well, actually, I lied. Before we do that, how do they detect their food? Like, we know that they smell and stuff, but they don't really have eyes, right? I mean,
no.
A little bit modified?
Yeah, they don't really have eyes. They can have modified tube feet to detect light and dark. called eye spots, but they really don't have any, I think mostly they smell their food.
Right.
I think that's their main
thing. And they can detect like light and dark, right?
Yes.
So it's kind of like if you were to close your eyes and then like I can tell it's lit right around here, and then if I were to cover my eyes, it's dark. So I can tell if there's like things moving around me based off of the light dark if my eyes were closed. So it's kind of like that, but it's not like they have eyes that are like ours that can detect, you know, they don't have cones and rods or anything like that.
Right.
Okay, so let's take a look at the video. This is one that we found on Vimeo. Anyway, this is just a video that we found of a sea star feeding, and you'll get a little bit more of a better idea of how they get it done. So it's pretty cool.
Like an advancing army, the sea stars move into position, slowly but surely working their way up toward their victims. Muscles cannot run or fight. All they can do is hide within their shells as their killers crawl over their bodies. Sensory tube feet sweep over the tightly packed mass of shells, searching for any gap in the muscles' defenses. Settling on its victim, the sea star hunkers down and begins its attack. The miniature camera, tucked within the mussel shell, gives us the first look ever at the carnage that unfolds here every day. Once the tube feet have physically breached the mussel's defensive line, the sea star's translucent stomach begins the final assault. The animal actually pushes its stomach inside the mussel's shell, unfolding like a fatal flower. The stomach unleashes a volley of chemical weapons, digestive juices that dissolve the mussel's soft pink flesh. All that's left is a nutrient-rich soup, a broth that's quickly absorbed by the sea star. Having assimilated the mussel, the sea star stomach pulls away. Leaving behind an empty shell.
So that gives you a really cool view. I found that video last year, just doing a Google search, but it was the first time Sandy and I saw it last year, and we were just like, whoa. Like,
crazy.
That's literally the first time.
Yeah.
I don't know of anybody, you know. So I love to share that video to show you what it's like inside of the clam there. Bye-bye clam. Rachel, so if they are exclusive to marine, if someone were to put them in fresh water, would they die? Yeah, right?
Yep, absolutely.
Yeah, they're not equipped to handle the fresh water. They need the salt water.
Yeah, in fact, at the aquarium, if the salinity changes even a little bit, then they don't do well.
Right, so they like it nice and stable.
Yeah.
Lots of salinity there. Okay, Burgundy, is it true that sea stars, if cut in half, they can regrow into two animals? It depends, right? But basically, like, you have to be able to get part of the central disc.
Right.
Right?
Exactly. That's actually one of their methods of asexual reproduction, where they can reproduce without really having any kind of fertilization of eggs and sperm, although they do that as well. But if you cut a sea star in half and you still have part of the central disc associated with each of those halves, then you can have two new sea stars.
Yeah. In some cases, depending on the species, right, it's going to vary quite a bit. But in some species, you don't even need to cut it in half. If you just had like two arms, as long as it's got part of that central disc, it'll grow back. Some of it you need more of the central disc, some of them you don't. But yeah, there is always that. Not like funny tale about how the fishermen, you know, were irritated about all the sea stars and that they were pulling up, and so they used to cut them up and throw them back, not realizing that they were literally doubling the population.
Yeah, exactly.
Vera, what are some predators that threaten sea stars?
Hmm.
That's a good question. So there are lots of animals. Like, I've seen gulls eating them. I've seen sea otters eating them. Sea otters will, like, stick two together, right? Like there's a funny picture of a sea otter that like made like a sea star sandwich. So their tube feet are sticking to each other and then can eat it, so the tube feet are all over the sea otter. Yeah. But yeah, there are other fish that will prey on them as well, but not, I don't know if there's a ton of animals, do you?
No, I don't think so, but actually there's been a disease this past mm-hmm. year going through our oceans, especially along the Pacific coast, called sea star wasting disease, that's actually affected a lot of populations of sea stars, particularly up in Washington and Oregon.
Yeah.
And even down into Southern California.
Yeah, we've heard a lot about that. You might have heard about it in the news. It's sea star wasting disease?
Yes.
Wasting disease, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. So did they ever figure out what it was? I thought I heard that it was like
a virus? It's or a bacteria. I can't remember what.
Yeah, I remember reading an article that they said that it's kind of like something that a lot of the sea stars have, but because they're being stressed, it's their immunities are weakening, and that's why it's coming out. It's not like they caught it per se, it's just that it took over.
Wow.
So I read an article, but that was like, oh, the latest research. I don't know if it was rebutted or anything like that. Rachel, this might sound weird, but when the star is eating the clam, does it hurt the mussel? I think there might be confusion. So write back if this isn't what you mean. A clam is different than a mussel. So a clam is an actual animal. A mussel is an actual animal. And they eat both clams and mussels. In which case, yes, it literally kills the animal. They've eaten it, they've dissolved it, and all that's left behind is the shell. So I think that's what you were asking, but they are actually two different animals. And if I'm wrong, just write back in. Let's see, Gabe, how slow do the sea stars move? It depends on the species. Like we were talking about the sunflower, right?
Yeah,
that moves pretty fast. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. Like, I mean, if I'm watching, it's kind of like
It's pretty slow. Like, I would say maybe an inch a minute, if that.
It's like it's just kind of like moving along.
Yeah,
but, like you're just
slow.
Watching. You're like, oh, it's going. Like, oh.
Yeah.
Yep. So, Sage, how do sea stars reproduce? Hang tight. We're gonna get to that. And Deborah, do sea stars consume anything other than mussels? Yes, they eat clams. We already kind of talked about some of the other things. We have filter feeding sea stars. They'll eat sponges. It depends on the species and where they're located. Okay, we have someone on the phone. Let's go to the phone lines. Who do we have with us today? Yolanda, hello, how are you?
Pretty good.
Good, what can we do for you?
Yeah, I have a question.
Okay.
Do starfish actually reproduce their arms and legs, and how so?
Yeah, so they do regenerate. So if like something were to be trying to eat it and it breaks off an arm, their arms will grow back. We do have a picture of one that's missing some arms. I think we skipped over it. Let me see. Oh no, maybe we haven't gotten there yet. We're coming up to it. Yeah, so we have a picture. I think it's picture number 12, sea star regeneration. If we can pull that up real quick. There we go. Can we go full screen?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so you can see, so this one, it's missing an arm here. It's probably going to have another arm here, an arm here. We've got a little one there, a little one there. So, yeah, this one's missing quite a few. But, yeah, they will actually grow back.
Wow.
All right. So, thank you. Any other questions?
No, that'll be it. Thank you so much.
All right. Thanks, Yolanda. All right. We have a couple other coming in here. Shannon, what are the sea stars' natural predators? We just talked about that. Janisha, are different marine species, hold on, we're waiting for it to come up, geared towards a certain salinity in the water, or whether or not water is mostly salt water or fresh water? How well would non-native species survive in brackish water? They probably wouldn't, unless they're already adapted to living in the brackish water. Like Sandy was saying, they're probably not going to survive. So they really need to stay within their salinity, and they do that. And there have actually been animals that have like moved because of these changes, right?
Oh, yeah. Especially like regarding our whole warming of the oceans thing. I was just reading an article about how many species are moving into out of their typical range because the water is getting too warm for them, so they're actually shifting northward. So the same thing would happen with the salinity too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Juline, does the disease affect any other species besides sea stars? It's really only sea stars, not sea urchins?
It is, but I've been reading something recently and hearing things about it affecting sea urchins as well. And we've been seeing a lot of sea urchins dead off of our coast, just when we go out diving. And,
yeah.
But I think that's more due to the warmer water. You know, the water temperatures have been 76, which is really super warm for this time of year.
We're normally like 65, right?
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
I mean, it's almost like 10, you know, between 5, 10 degrees warmer than normal. And animals, if they can't adapt that quick, they don't survive.
Exactly.
Gabriel, let's see, got a question. Do some clams and mussels have defense against the way sea stars tend to eat them? Or is their only and main defense keeping their shell really tight? It's only keeping it tight, right?
Yeah.
I don't know of any other defense. Yeah, just keeping it tight and not being weak. So, all right, let's see. Can we get a picture of the sea star stomach up as well? I think that's picture number 11. We kind of skipped over to get to the video. But their stomach, like it says, it's just this kind of gelatinous thing, right?
Yeah.
Can we go full screen on this? So right in here.
Yep, that's their stomach.
I'm going to change this to red. I think it's, there we go. Okay, now I'm red. So, so that's the jelly part. We have the 2 feet right here. And then the stomach here. And then they just slurp it back up.
Yeah, that's a bat star.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, as far as reproduction, you mentioned already that there's essentially asexual reproduction. That's where they can split and do a clone of themselves, basically, right?
Right.
But they also do eat spawning events.
They can release eggs and sperm, where typically, if one sea star starts to spawn, then it's a cue for all the others to spawn at the same time. So they release eggs and sperm into the water, and then the eggs and sperm meet in the water column, and then they'll actually drift. They have a ciliated free swimming larvae, and they kind of drift in the ocean until they're ready to settle down and find a suitable substrate. And when they find the right cues, then they start growing into a sea star.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. So there's the asexual reproduction and sexual reproduction. And it's normally like a water thing. Is that what often triggers the sea stars to spawn?
Is that it is at the aquarium.
Yeah. Yeah. The water temperature gets a little warm.
Yeah.
I mean, we're talking a degree or two.
Yeah.
We can see some spawning in the exhibit.
Yeah.
So,
it's crazy.
Yeah. Let's see. Shannon, how does the sea star sense of smell work? Well, we know it's with the 2 feet.
It's with the 2 feet, but maybe smell isn't the best word. Maybe it's more tasting the water.
Maybe tasting.
Yeah, it's hard. They don't really have the 5 senses like we do. But
there's no brain to process it, right?
Exactly. So it's probably more that they can just sense chemicals in the water. That means, oh, this is food.
Right. Yeah, so I don't think we ever even mentioned that, but these animals don't have a brain or a heart. These are all invertebrates that are... I guess simple, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
In the case compared to us, very simple.
But echinoderms are actually pretty far up the evolutionary chain as far as invertebrates go and the different phyla.
Yeah. Lena, you were saying that the sea stars are getting diseases. Would we be able to help against that?
Mm.
It's not totally understood yet, right?
No, it's not. It seems to be getting better now, actually. It's been about a year since that's been going on, and they're starting to see very juvenile, very small sea stars come back again. So I think things are changing for the better right now.
Hopefully.
And we don't know why, but
it's
getting
was
better.
Was it one species? There was a couple of species, but not all sea stars. Like, were bat stars being affected
bat
by it?
Bat stars were least affected.
Yeah.
And we even saw that in our aquarium. So there must have been something in the water that was affecting them, but we don't fully understand
it's
it
not
yet.
Fully understood. Saray, I hope I said your name right. Once the sea star is dead, can it still stay stuck on objects?
No.
Right.
Mm-mm.
Yeah, it has to use that water vascular system, which means it's moving water in and out, and it can't do that if it's dead. All right, let's move on and talk about sea urchins. Now, they have something called an Aristotle's lantern that they use for feeding. Now, their mouths are on the bottom, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So we'll go full screen here on this picture. It's kind of interesting. So just to orient you, actually, can we go to picture number 14, please, real quick? So here's sea urchins, right? So this is a sea urchin here, sea urchin. These are two different types. And they have 2 feet that have them holding onto the rocks. Now, can we go to that next picture? Because what we're going to see is we're going to have a sea urchin that was basically cut in half. So we're looking at the inside. If you can imagine that there's like another part in there. The mouth is on the bottom here. And then this part right here, I don't know, maybe it's upside down. That part there is the Aristotle's lantern. What is that like?
Well, that is basically what they use to chew their food. They're primarily grazers. They're algae eaters. And so they have this very strong looking mouth parts that's, you know, this thing called Aristotle's lantern. It's basically their jaw. And this strong thing that takes up so much space in their test or their shell, their skeleton, is actually used to scrape away algae as it moves along the rocks. Now that they don't just eat algae, of course, they eat other things like sponges and tunicates, detritus and bryozoans, but this is just basically their feeding mechanism, which they use to scrape things off the rocks.
Yeah, and one of their big foods with the algae is kelp. So we talked about how there are the holdfasts on kelp, and that's really strong, like fibrous material that, you know, is gripping the kelp onto the rock, but they literally have these Aristotle's lantern, the teeth, they're like little horny plates, will go crunch through it. I need to remember this video. I'm going to try and find it when we're on break. I'm going to make a note so we can try and watch it when we come back. But you can actually see them crunching through the kelp. So I think it's a BBC video. See if we can find it. But it's really, really cool. Now, how do they defend themselves? I mean, they obviously have the spikes, but things can get in between spikes. So what do they do then?
Well, they can have venom in their spines. There are some tropical urchins, like the long-spined sea urchin, that actually has venom in its spine. So you want to stay away from those if you're diving in tropical waters. But they also have these pincher-like organisms in between the spines called pedicellaria. And pedicellaria can contain a toxin or a venom it can be mild or it can be very venomous. In fact, there are some urchins that have very strong pedicellaria that I once got for the aquarium many years ago, and then I was like, be careful handling these because they wouldn't kill you, of course, but that you would definitely feel their sting. So it
Which
can be pretty strong.
Those?
The tropical jeweled urchins, they're called, or the flower hat urchins. I can't remember what they're beautiful urchins.
Yeah. Can we go full screen on this? And the pedicellaria are, what are they? These things here, right?
Like, yes.
It's kind of hard to.
Yeah.
So these are the spikes, but then between that are all these little.
Right. Things. Pedicellaria.
We have a couple questions. I didn't see who the last one was. I did read it, though. It says, did we just say that they don't have brains and hearts? And yes, these animals do not have brains and they don't have hearts, but they do have sensorability, right? They can sensor and kind of feel things and taste, but they don't have the same kind of processing that you would have if you had a brain.
Right.
Michelle, why have so many surgeons been dying recently? We think it has to do with the sea star wasting disease, maybe, or
the water temperature.
Or the water temperature.
I think that's probably the bigger thing right now.
Yeah, warmer water.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Now, there tend to be some symbiotic relationships as far as small shrimp and cardinal fish, they'll live within the sea urchins as well?
Yes. I mean, you can imagine this fortress of spines is a great place for a little thing to live. So you find little shrimp fish, which are these long, thin fish that actually sort of blend in with the urchin spines. Cardinal fish, even cuttlefish, and mandarin fish can live among these spines.
And just keep in mind that we've only shown a couple of different species. Some of these have really long spikes, like the purple one we showed, were like teeny tiny spikes kind of around the test there. And the test is like Sandy was saying, it's kind of like their skeleton. It's not made of bone. It's more like a shell that's their internal structure. But yeah, so some of them have these super long spines, and that makes it easy for these fish to live in the teeny tiny spikes. Probably not so easy, but it just depends on the species. We have a video of lots of sea urchins from the kelp forest here. So if we can go to our YouTube video, we'll be able to show you a little bit more of kelp forest underwater with these sea urchins.
There's cathedral trees, there's the understory, there's plants and animals all over the place making their living. It's hugely productive. It converts the the nutrients of this cold seawater into algae and then plankton and then into fish and then into the seabirds. And so it populates the ocean with fish, it populates the air with birds, and without them, we would have vastly fewer species, a lot less biomass here on the ocean side, and this whole ecosystem, this whole intricate web of life just wouldn't exist.
So well, I was hoping we had some of the sea urchins in there, but I'll find it on the other video. But anyway, with the sea urchins in the kelp forest, right, like we have gotten sea urchin barrens,
yeah,
right?
So many of them that they just graze everything.
Right, they eat all that kelp. And so the whole point with the video, I thought we had sea urchins in there, is that these kelp forests, as we learned on Kelp Forest Day, house like thousands of animals, and these sea urchins, if they're not kind of kept in check, can destroy these areas where there's kelp forests. Sage, does the poison on the sea urchins' backs be used to keep back predators? And what are the kind of predators of sea urchins?
Well, sea otters are probably one of the biggest predators of sea urchins. And that's really why we get urchin barrens down here in Southern California, because many, many years ago, there were otters in Southern California. But without that major predator now, then the urchins have kind of populated to the point where they're mowing down large quantities of the kelp forest.
Right.
So it's a big problem.
Yeah, and you know, for a long time I've heard, you know, scuba divers, hey, if you see sea urchins, feel free to collect those, right? Because we have so many off of our coast. When I was younger, my dad went scuba diving with a friend, and there's video of the guy that brought this bag of stuff up that he was gonna show, and he had sea urchins, and he literally just flipped it over and just took a spoon to it because people eat
oh,
sea
yeah.
urchin
uni.
Uni is sea urchin, so I would never do that, but props to him for that. Yeah. All right, so let's see. Ian, do sea urchins live in colonies? Not like specifically, right? Like we can have a bunch, but they don't need each other to survive like coral
right.
colonies, right?
Right, exactly.
All right, so let's move on to the sea cucumber. Now, this is the one that is bilateral, so this is the one that you can only cut in half and have it mirror each other. They have some interesting feeding techniques, though, too, right?
Yeah, they actually have modified tube feet around their mouth, which they use to sort of filter or bring in sand into their mouth and filter out the detritus. So they're primarily deposit feeders, as they're known, but there are also some sea cucumbers that have elaborate tentacles around their mouth that capture filter feeding organisms and then bring those branches sort of into their mouth and sort of wipe off all of the, like the plankton that they capture out of the water.
We actually have a picture of feeding tentacles. It should be picture number 18, I believe, if we can bring that up. There we go. Can we go full screen on this? So that's pretty interesting there.
Yeah, that's the filter feeding sea cucumber. And oftentimes, you know, they'll capture little organisms out of the water. And then, I don't know if that one, no, that one doesn't show it. But each one of those branches then will be swept sort of inside their mouth and scraped clean of any plankton. And then it just goes back out and filter feeds some more.
Now, this one looks kind of scary. Can we go back to the other photo just of the sea cucumber number 17. Now this looks like it has spines and it belongs to the phylum called spiny skin, but they're not actual spines here, right?
No, they're more like fleshy spines. They look more ominous than they actually are. I've seen these tropical sea cucumbers in places like Guam and other places, and they're very interesting because they're quite large, and oftentimes you turn them over and you can see like symbiotic animals, crabs and stuff, living in their mouth.
Wow.
So it's really cool.
Some of these secrete toxins, but not all. Is that right?
That's correct. In fact, some of the more common suspension feeders, the filter feeders, they're brightly colored, and we call them sea apples. They'll be like bright orange or yellow or pink. And I think this is advertising that they are toxins, so stay away, because they really don't have any spines or any other way of protecting themselves.
Now, if they were to, let's say there's a predator coming to eat them, a fish or a bird or something like that, they kind of have a unique way of trying to get away. So what do they do?
Well, they have two mechanisms. I mean, Well, there are different types of mechanisms. Some sea cucumbers can actually exude these really sticky filaments. Mm-hmm. And I think it's more a distraction for the predators. And then the sea star kind of escapes. But really, even cooler than that is that some species of sea cucumbers eviscerate, which means they actually exude or expel their gut and mm-hmm. the other internal organs through their mouth or their anus in the hopes of distracting the predators.
It's kind of like, then, eat this.
Right, instead of me. And then they escape, and then they'll regrow those internal organs again.
Because, yeah, remember that one of the characteristics of this phylum is that they can regenerate. So we've talked about, like, the, you know, spines of a sea urchin can regenerate, the arms of a sea star can regenerate, and then the, like, guts of the sea cucumber regenerate. So really fascinating stuff there that... Eat my guts.
Right. Not me.
Not me. And then getting away. Now, they also have a unique symbiotic relationship, like you said, with crabs, shrimps, and worms. But there's one in particular, the pearlfish.
Yeah,
the pearlfish. This pearl is disgusting. Fish. But it is a very interesting story. Tell me about
it. It is. Sandy. It's a very long, thin fish, as you can see here. And it's perfectly shaped to live in the anus or the gut cavity of the sea cucumbers. And it leaves and enters through the anus, tail first. And it feeds a little bit on the gonads and the internal tissues of the sea cucumber, but it's not enough to harm the sea cucumber, so it can continue living. So you would consider the pearlfish parasitic in to some extent, but more it's commensalist, which means that it's neutral. It doesn't bother the sea cucumber, and the sea cucumber doesn't bother the pearlfish. In fact, the sea cucumber provides a home for the pearlfish.
Yeah, very, very fun, interesting there. We read a paper, this was a while ago, so I can't totally remember how long, but in the case that a sea cucumber hasn't had to eviscerate, it'll actually do it on purpose just so it can regrow and have like fresh guts, basically.
Wow.
So, because if it hasn't had a need, then they kind of start to go bad anyway. So
wow,
I think it's like every, cool. I want to say 6 weeks, but I can't totally remember. So
the new colon cleanse.
Yeah.
Huh?
The new bad diet, right? Just get rid of the guts. No.
Right.
All right. So let's see. Sage, how big can a sea cucumber get? What is the big, I don't know what the biggest one is.
But I've seen some in the tropics that are at least this big.
Yeah,
like that long and that at least that
thick.
Wide. Yeah,
the ones at the aquarium are only, you know,
yeah,
like maybe
6-8 inches,
so not very big. Janisha, why do people believe that kissing a sea cucumber gives 7 years of good luck?
I don't know.
I mean, I've heard that as well, but I don't know kind of the tale behind that, so I don't know. I'm not sure how to pronounce your name. Yaxiv, maybe. You can always tell me how to say it too. What is the significance between the relationship of the sea cucumber and the fish that lives in its anus? It's just how the animal survives, right? It's a relationship that somewhere along the line worked.
I mean, this pearlfish could not live in any other way. It couldn't live on its own. It has to live inside a sea cucumber. So it's perfectly adapted for that reason.
Isn't that weird how that happened?
Is. Yeah.
But yeah. All right, and then just to wrap up some of the other species that would be considered an echinoderm, like the sand dollars, right?
Sand dollars. Yeah,
they fit the criterion. What else? Heart urchins? I'm actually not familiar what a heart urchin is.
It's sort of like a sand dollar that's inflated. It looks like a sort of a puffed up one.
Okay, I do know what
more
that
tropical species, I think, than anything.
Yeah, so we have a picture of a sand dollar we can bring up. I believe it's picture number 21. There we go. And these are filter feeders.
Yeah, you can see these at the aquarium.
Yeah, but they have 2 feet, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And they primarily eat copepods.
Uh-huh.
And there's a very interesting relationship between them and sand stars, where you'll find zones of sand dollars. Like you can even go to Redondo Beach or any of the beaches and find zones of sand dollars just under the surf zone, like a little bit deeper than that. And then there are also sand stars that kind of keep the sand dollars in this zone, because I believe they're predators of sand, sand dollars.
Interesting.
But yeah, they stand up like that and they're purple. Most people see them when they're on the beach, mm-hmm. they see them as white skeletons. Those are the dead sand dollars. The living sand dollars are actually, they look fuzzy and purple.
Yeah, and they're kind of like, they almost feel a little rubbery maybe, kind of like a sea star.
Yeah.
They kind of like bristly because of the little spines that they have. And
they're fascinating.
I have never seen any here though. Like when I went to school on the East Coast, we used to go to some of the bays and we would see a bunch there, but I've actually never seen any here.
Yeah, so. For the aquarium, we collect them off of Redondo Beach. Oh. So they're big beds of them there.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Darwin, how does the sea cucumber reproduce? They are spawners as well, is that right?
Yes,
I think they're spawners as well, so they're going to release the sperm and the eggs. Anna, does the pearlfish have somewhat the same benefits such as the cleaner fish? Basically, I mean, it just lives inside of the sea cucumber instead of outside cleaning, but yeah. All right, so what we're gonna do now is take a break. So we have finished up our section on echinoderms, the spiny skinned, and then we will be moving on to our crustaceans. Basically, we're gonna be talking about arthropods and more specifically crustaceans, which are within the arthropods, when we get back. So we'll take a 5-minute break, get a drink, stretch, get a snack, whatever you gotta do, and we'll see you back here in a couple minutes.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Thank you. makes sense because most of my friends from high school were attending other universities within the area. I wanted to branch off and establish my own network, and that's exactly what I found here at Dominguez Hills, a great network.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, welcome back. Wait, I think we're back. Yeah, it looks like we're back now. I was waiting for our Cal State Dominguez Hills. Anyway, okay, so welcome back. What we're going to do right now is our mystery item. So I have a picture. If we can pull the picture up from the computer, basically the mystery item for today is, what are we looking at? So I'll wait for this to come up. There we go. Now, not the orange part there, but the blue and white things. So there's two. I want to know what those are. And while you are thinking about that, we can leave that up. I'm going to answer some questions. You can just leave that up for a second. Aylin, how do sand dollars reproduce? Are they spawners as well? Yep. They must be, right? Spawning. Yep. All right, Deborah, how do sand dollars work? Are they like urchins and don't have brains or hearts but still have the ability to move around? Basically, yeah, right?
Yep, very closely related to urchins. Like a flattened one.
Yes, like a flattened one, right. Aylin, is the field trip considered an assignment or extra credit? It is an assignment, and you'll see that in your syllabus as well. The extra credit is a lab. Kristen, if you get stung by a sea urchin, is it from the venom in its spine or the toxin between the spines?
It could
be. If
you
were to get stung, yeah.
It could be either, but more common it is from the spine. And sometimes, even if the spine doesn't contain venom, like those long spine urchins that I was mentioning earlier, it can still get stuck in your skin and cause an infection. So it's really important to get it looked at or at least flushed out and try to get that piece of spine out of there as quickly as possible.
Yeah. All right, so we'll leave this picture up for just another moment. So what is this? And to the studio folks, are we allowed to play the urchin video? Did we get word on that yet? Hold on. So I found that sea urchin video. I just want to make sure we can play it. Okay, yeah, so it's a Planet Earth video. So I'm going to play that for you. And this is the one that shows the sea urchin and that Aristotle's lantern.
Drama as in any other forest, but the cast is less familiar. An army of sea urchins is mounting an attack. The urchin plague strikes at the kelp's holdfasts, their crucial attachments to the rock. Extremely tough, but each urchin has 5 teeth which are self-sharpening and are replaced every few months. Urchins fell vast areas of kelp forest, creating clearings.
You can see those like teeth like coming out and just crunching on that hard material from the kelp, so kind of cool. All right, we're going to now move on to our second part of today. So we're going to be talking about crustaceans, which belong under the phylum arthropods. So first, let's introduce arthropods. What are arthropods?
Well, when we typically think of arthropods, we think of insects or bugs. And of course, insects are a large part of it, but it also includes many other animals like crabs, shrimp, millipedes, and even the extinct trilobites. So they're literally everywhere. They are the most diverse phylum, and at least half of the 1.4 million described species on Earth, half of them are arthropods. So that gives you some indication of how diverse and abundant they are. And they're mostly insects. The fossil record dates back to 530 million years ago, so they're very, very old.
So yeah, and when I think of arthropods, like you said, thinking of bugs, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, like any kind of bug on a flower flying around. But now that I've, you know, gone through all my bio classes and stuff like that, when I think of arthropod, I think of jointed foot.
Yes.
Like literally, like if it has joints on the legs, like you can like draw the joints out. It's an arthropod. And that has helped me, like when I'm looking at an animal, like, oh, what kind of... It's an arthropod. It's got some joints going on there.
Yeah, and that's exactly what arthropod means in Latin. Arthro means jointed and pod means foot.
And this is considered, like we said, like there's so many animals, and this might even possibly be the biggest phylum in the world, right, that contains the most amount.
Yeah.
So pretty interesting. Now, the segmentation on this, oops, sorry, can you go back to the full screen there? So here's what we were talking about, like joint, 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 joint. Joint, 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 joint. So all these jointed parts there. So if you see the joints, then you've got an arthropod. All right, let's see. We have a bunch of guesses here. So I'm just going to read some of them. Julian asked if it's a type of shrimp. Anna asked if it was a chameleon shrimp. Sydney, a blue-spotted harlequin shrimp. Janisha got it right first. She wrote in harlequin shrimp. So it is a harlequin shrimp. Deborah also got it right. Kristen's name is up there. She also got it right. So lots of you guys got it. Well, that was an easy one.
Yeah. I'll have to think of a harder one next year, huh?
Yeah. So today's question of the day, if we can bring that up, otherwise I will totally forget. What does the harlequin crab eat? Or no, harlequin shrimp. Yeah, it's a harlequin shrimp. What does the harlequin shrimp eat? So that's your question of the day. Do not write that in. That is something to add onto the participation tab on Blackboard if you still need to get points. All right, or if you're not watching live. So moving on, talking about some arthropods here, let's talk a little bit more specifically. So we talked about the jointed appendages. What else are the characteristics of an arthropod?
Well, the segmented bodies, similar to annelids, which are worms, they are also segmented and they're very closely related to arthropods. But the segmented bodies of the arthropods are basically divided into a head, a thorax, and an abdomen. So mm-hmm. It's three basic parts here. And there's many different variations of these different parts that make up a lobster or a shrimp or a crab, but they are all basically related and have the same sort of body plan.
Can we go full screen just to point it out again? So we're talking about the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. So, okay, walk me through that again.
So the head, the thorax is the center part.
And here's the thorax.
And then the abdomen is usually the tail part.
Okay.
And so they all, like even crabs have this body plan where the abdomen is sort of tucked underneath their body.
So when we go to, we have a crab we're going to look at today. So essentially just remember that this part tucks under the body.
That's right.
Okay. Alrighty. Now, they're also known for their exoskeleton.
That's correct.
Right? And yes. Tell me about that.
Well, their exoskeleton is made of chitin. So unlike the echinoderms, which we just talked about, which have an internal skeleton, these guys are constrained or restricted by an external skeleton. And it's made of chitin, which is a very high molecular weight nitrogenous saccharide polymer. So I sort of think of it as like your fingernails. I don't know if it's the exact same compound, but it's tough but flexible. Mm-hmm. So you can they can get movement, and the movement is comes from the jointed appendages, but as far as growth goes, if you want to get bigger, you have this hard exoskeleton, so it makes it very difficult to grow, but they have a unique way of handling that, which is called ecdysis or molting. And that's where they shed their old skin and mm-hmm. they essentially build a new one.
So, if you, going back to kind of the fingernail, like when we're babies, we have a small little finger and a thumbnail. If our nail didn't grow, but our finger did, but like it's almost like there's a bigger nail underneath, so the little one pops off, yeah. right? And then like there's a bigger one underneath. Obviously ours doesn't do that. But there's also like a, it's kind of soft, like they're too big for their current exoskeleton, so they molt or they back out of it, right, and kind of leave the old one behind. But then their bodies are kind of soft for a while as they're hardening back up, right?
Yeah, they're very vulnerable during this time. And of course, when they're younger, like younger crabs, shrimps, and lobsters, they do it more frequently. They go through this molting process because they're growing very quickly. Older adult specimens, maybe less frequently. We have some very large lobsters in our aquarium, and pretty much every year at the same time, they'll molt. As they do in the wild at the same time. Mm-hmm. And then they hide somewhere until that hard shell can get tough again, and then they can go out and do their thing again.
With our spider crabs, when they molt, do we separate them out? So because yeah. they're soft for a little while, how long are they separated out?
Usually about a week or so. But even after a week, it sometimes can take them a bit longer to harden up.
Hmm. Yeah. So exoskeletons we use at the aquarium to talk about. So it looks like you essentially have this dead, like, lobster. But really, it's just the skeleton or the outside skeleton. There's nothing inside because it crawled, it backed out of it. I should have looked for that, the molting video.
Oh, yes.
We have that one on YouTube. If you were to do a Google search of Aquarium of the Pacific and look up crab molting, you would see this kind of sped up video in the last few minutes of a spider crab backing out of its molt. It's so much bigger. Yeah. Like, you know, it's got to be like jeans that are too tight, just bulging, you know, and then like
it looks so uncomfortable.
Out, you know? Because when he backs out of the molt and then he stretches out, you're like, he's so much bigger than the little molt that he just backed out of.
Yeah, it is so crazy, the difference.
Yeah. Jasmine, does the back of the shrimp help them in anything? I'm not sure what you mean by the back of the shrimp. Write back and give me a little bit more info what you're asking. Now, these guys also have compound eyes, is that right?
Yes, these are distinct photoreceptive units that are side by side, so they can detect movement, but not really accurately, like mm-hmm. we can, you know. They can more see shadows and movement around them, and depending on the degree of the overlap of the distinct photoreceptive units, they can either, you know, if they overlap too much, they'll have poor visual acuity, but if they are not, then they can see a little bit better. So, but they don't see very clearly, really.
Right, not great at seeing, yeah. Sydney, what are some of the benefits of the exoskeleton for the crustaceans? Well, once they've shed it, nothing, right?
Right.
I mean, it could be a food source for other animals, but nothing other than that, but I mean, maybe just kind of the benefits of molting.
Certainly growth. But I think in general, the exoskeleton serves as protection for the crustaceans. Mm-hmm. In addition to have maybe pinchers or some other kind of defense, it's just basically a hard-shelled thing, so it's more difficult to eat than something that's soft.
Sure. Okay. Now, just to touch base on the trilobites, these guys are extinct, but there were an estimated 4,000 different species of trilobites, and they dominated the seas during the Cambrian period. So between 440 and 550 million years ago, they were the significant group. So kind of interesting. We have a picture of a fossil here. If we can bring that up, image number 26, I believe. Kind of interesting looking there, right? These remind me quite a bit of the horseshoe crab. I don't know. I think we have a picture of horseshoe crab number 27. Kind of interesting, right? They look very similar. Now, these are still around. Now, these are not a crustacean, though, right?
They're an arthropod, but not a crustacean. They're actually more related to spiders than they are to crabs.
Right, another arthropod, right? Spiders have jointed arms there, jointed
right.
legs. We also have insects, so we're familiar with those. And then crustaceans, specifically what we're going to talk the rest of the class about are the crabs, lobsters, shrimps, and barnacles. Now, these guys, there's a lot of them, as we mentioned, roughly 67,000 different species. They're pretty important, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, of course, they serve as a great source of food for us because we like to eat crabs, shrimp, and lobsters. But they're also important critical in the food web as well, because as you can imagine, all of those crustaceans crawling on the bottom, they help to eat dead things. So a lot of them are scavengers and play a critical role in our food webs.
Yeah, definitely. A couple of questions. Can we scroll back up to the top? So Jasmine, what I meant was, how does the exoskeleton benefit or help the lobster? So I think we hit on that about how it's the protection, right? It hardens up. It ends up like, it's almost like their skin secretes a hard shell on top to protect the nice meaty parts. Sydney, what are some of the benefits of the exoskeleton? So we talked about that. Anna, is the chitin like, or is it like cartilage? I wouldn't say like cartilage. I would say it's more like keratin, like a fingernail.
Yeah.
But not cartilage. Yeah. Lena, what was the video of the crab on YouTube called? If you did a Google search for Aquarium of the Pacific spider crab molt, you'll probably find it. How do the crustaceans reproduce? So that's from Kimberly. Hang tight, we're gonna talk about that. All right, so let's talk about the crustaceans. I already mentioned there's around 67,000 different species. Mostly are marine, but some are fresh, is that right?
Some are freshwater, some are brackish water, and actually some are semi-terrestrial. There are some crabs that live on mountaintops on some tropical islands. And as long as they stay moist and their gills can stay moist, they can still breathe. And they, to reproduce, they actually go down to the sea to release their eggs and sperm. So it's
really
fascinating.
Would that be like the hermit crabs that people sell like in touristy shops, and you can change their shells and...
Yeah, now hermit crabs, I don't know if they do the same thing. I'm thinking of the red crabs of that famous island. Maybe Christmas Tree Island or Christmas Island, where the crabs come down. But hermit crabs are also a good example of that.
Right. Okay. And this is also considered the most diverse group in terms of form. Now we have a cool picture here of a spiny lobster. You'll find a spiny lobster off of our coast. This is what people go fishing for or diving for when it's lobster season. But I think one of the cool things about these is that you'll notice there's no pinchers.
No.
Right?
No,
when people think of lobsters, they normally think of pinchers, but not on these guys.
Right. They just depend on their quick speed. And their, if you also look at their thorax, remember that center section in the middle, there are some spines on there, some short ones. And I think that helps to keep predators away.
When people go diving for lobsters, they will like whip their tail, you know, back and forth. You got to watch out because those spines will get you. So that's one of their main defenses there. So some of the characteristics that define the crustacean, we already kind of mentioned that the body is composed of the head, thorax, and abdomen, but they also have a pair of appendages on each body segment.
Right.
Right?
They have five pairs around their head and two pairs of antenna, and then each pair around each of their body segments.
Yeah, we can go full screen on this. So you were saying that we have these here, right? We're talking about these.
Yeah.
And then the pinchers, they have the antennae, so a lot going on there.
Yeah, and even those swimming appendages on the tail,
right here,
the abdomen, those are modified appendages as well.
All right. Now this is more
they
of
just
a,
use them for different functions.
Different lobster. That one's got pinchers, right?
Yeah, that's a Maine lobster.
And then you said, again, the compound eyes. So another type of group of crustaceans that are super important, and we already mentioned them earlier as far as feeding, but copepods.
Yeah.
Right? And these are generally, I mean, they're a plankton, right?
Yeah. They actually compose about 90% of the plankton, the zooplankton, that means animal plankton, in the oceans. And they play a very critical role as in our food webs, because a lot of animals rely on copepods for their primary food source. So they're pretty important.
Right. Another one that we'll mention are amphipods. There's about 8,000 different species. Now these range from 1 millimeter to the giant deep sea benthic species reaching around 25 centimeters. So that's a little bit of a big hop. These are ones that if you're at the beach, kind of by the rocks or in seaweed, you might see little things like jumping. Like they remind me of little sea fleas is like, right? Like right. What I would call them. So those are little amphipods. And then there's isopods.
Yes. Now isopods look similar to amphipods, but as you could see in the previous picture, the amphipods are squished side to side. Well, isopods are squished top to bottom. So they're sort of flattened, and there are about 10,000 species of isopods. They live in marine, freshwater, and terrestrial habitats. They can be very small, like half of a millimeter, up to 19 inches or so. And these are very similar to the roly-polies, or the pill bugs that you know on land. And they're basically the same group, but just very different. These are the marine isopods. Most of these guys are scavengers, and some are parasitic. We actually have one of these giant isopods that you're seeing here at the Aquarium of the Pacific, so definitely come down and check it out.
That's what I described to them, like the roly-polies of the sea.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned parasitic. We actually have a picture. Ooh. This one here, it's just so gross.
Don't show me this.
What's going on here, Sandy?
Well, this is an isopod that is parasitic, and it's living off the tissues of the fish, and it's basically living in the mouth. It's attached inside of its mouth, and it will stay there and live off of that fish until something eats the fish. It basically won't kill the fish, and sometimes even when we collect fish, we'll bring them in and we'll find these little isopods either here in the mouth or in their gill cavity, and we have to physically remove them, which is a lot tougher than you think because they really have hooks on their mm-hmm. appendages that they really hunker down.
In this case, the isopod goes in, eats part of the fish's tongue away, and then attaches and essentially becomes part of the tongue so it can eat the leftover pieces of food in the fish's mouth. That's disgusting.
Yeah, it's gross.
We have found fish, like, so we've done trawls where we, you know, put a net in the water and pulled some stuff up, and we found fish that had these in their mouth, and
I know. I don't like them.
Not for me. A couple questions. Cynthia, how are the immense amount of marine life species recorded?
Oh.
Researchers, right? I mean, they're just constantly doing collections, identifying what they find. And it's not like one person says, oh, I'm going to identify plankton and crabs and fish. Like, there's people that specialize in plankton, people that specialize in crabs.
And often what they'll do is an institution like the Scripps Institute of Oceanography will send a research vessel out for like a long cruise, maybe for 6 months or more, and they'll have a team of scientists, and each scientist will specialize in one of these different groups, and as they collect specimens, you know, either through maybe sampling different parts of the ocean, whether it be the bottom, the middle, the surface, then the scientists will come and look at everything that they brought up, and they'll separate it out and have each scientist sort of identify what's out there. And it's a very time-consuming process.
Very tedious. And the more you find, the more you have to go through to catalog. You might think you have a new species, but you might have thousands to go through before you go, oh, okay, it's actually new. And
right.
So very, very tedious process. Jacqueline, what would happen if crabs and lobsters were overfished? Well, just like any animal that has its role in the ecosystem, that plays its role in the niche, it's going to throw the balance off for sure. And there have actually been like lobsters that have been overfished and crabs, right? And
oh, yeah.
Do you know what some of the effects in some of those very obviously very specific locations have been?
No,
I mean, I'm sure
don't.
There's papers published on it. We just would have to go read and see.
Yeah.
Let's see, Jasmine, does the little animal harm the fish in any way? Yes, it eats its tongue. So, or in the case, like you said, the gills, right? It'll get in on the gills. I don't know if it kills it. I don't think it kills it.
No,
right?
It just weakens it, unfortunately.
Yeah. All right, so now another part, we'll talk about decapods. Decapods would include hermit crabs, which are not considered a true crab, right?
That's right.
So what makes a hermit crab a hermit crab?
Well, hermit crabs have four pairs of walking legs. So if you look at this hermit crab, for example, you can count four legs, kind of. The fifth leg is sort of a modified leg that is used to hold on the shell. So they often lived in these abandoned gastropods shells. And they'll have pinchers, much like the true crabs do, for food and feeding, and they're mostly marine.
Yeah, and their body is pretty soft, which is why, like, compared to other crabs, you know, where they have that exoskeleton that's nice and hard, that's why they have to find refuge in these other left-behind shells. We'll talk about those shells on Mollusk Day, which is next week. But yeah, as far as the shells that are left behind by these snails, these guys have to crawl into them and use it as protection since their body's not hard like other crabs. And as far as true crabs, what about them? What makes them a little different?
Well, true crabs have five pairs of legs, and the front pair is modified as pinchers, as you can see here. They're mostly marine. There are some freshwater and semi-terrestrial species as well. But even, as I mentioned before, from the Christmas Island crabs, they rely on the ocean for breeding and for larval development. So they still have to go down to the sea to release their eggs and sperm. But there are about 10,000 species of true crabs.
That's a lot.
Yeah.
It's so hard to believe there's so many different species. I mean, you just don't, we're not exposed to them, so it's hard to believe there's so many.
Yeah.
Quickly, we'll go through shrimp. So shrimp are another type of animal here, decapod. There's around 2,600 species. We know them because we eat them, right, in a lot of cases, but there's lots of different species. This one, is this a peppermint shrimp here?
Scarlet cleaner shrimp.
Yes, scarlet cleaner shrimp, yeah. So cleaning up the little clownfish there, and that's pretty important.
Yeah, this shrimp actually does the same thing sort of as a cleaner wrasse does, or a cleaner fish does, where they'll pick the parasites off of the fish. And I think I'm not certain of this, but I'm pretty sure that most of those cleaner shrimp have those very long white antenna mm-hmm. as a cue for the fish to say, hey, I'm a cleaner shrimp, so
right.
come on over.
It's all safe.
Yeah.
Lobsters. So we have like California spiny lobsters that do not have claws, but then the Maine lobsters are the ones that do. And you mentioned that earlier, right?
Yeah, they have very big claws.
So if people are gonna order lobster to eat, and they're gonna eat the claws, right? It wouldn't be from ones that you found off California. Here's an example.
Yeah,
can you
here's
go full
a great...
screen on this? Perfect. Big claws.
Big claws. And actually the record weight for one of these guys is 44 pounds.
Wow.
So they can get pretty big.
Pretty big, yes.
It's a dog.
Yeah, right? Yeah. My dog's only 20 pounds.
Oh,
so
yeah.
He's a good sized dog, I think, you know, for a small dog. And then we have barnacles. So barnacles are suspension feeders. But remember, they might look like a mussel, like they have the soft bodied. But barnacles are arthropods, so they have jointed appendages that they use for feeding. And we have a video. Actually, can we go full screen on this real quick? So right here. And then there's actually kind of a big one here. So they secrete the exoskeleton, which is what looks like the shell, kind of like a muscle, but it's not a muscle. They don't have a soft body on the inside, but there's going to be like a little appendage that comes out. It's their foot that's kind of feathery, and that's what helps them filter feed. So if we can go into the video, we'll actually get a chance to see that in a second. There we go.
So cool. They're basically kicking out their feet to capture the plankton in the water. And their head, they're sort of upside down in this, the shell that they've cemented.
And they, you'll find these on whales. So barnacles will attach and embed into the skin and blubber of whales and catch a free ride so they can filter feed. Very specific species live on very specific whales too. All right, so if we can bring it back. Now, as far as characteristics that define crustaceans, it's basically like everything we've talked about before, right? So they molt. What else? Anything else? I'm trying to think. So, the molting is regulated by the hormone ectosine, is that right? Ectosone?
Yeah, it's a very long, complicated process that requires a ton of energy for the whatever is molting, whatever animal is molting. And like Kira was saying earlier, you know, they're so much bigger when they come out, and they're so vulnerable when they're going through this molting process. But this is essentially what they have to do in order to grow. And what's so amazing is not only do they I guess, harden the external features, but they also molt or shed the internal features, like even their gills will shed and their mouth parts will shed. So everything is shedded to have this new shell. It's really incredible.
Can we go back full screen on this? I just was going to point out. So what's happening is the back of the crab essentially has lifted up. He's backing out of his exoskeleton. So here is the new, or like the actual crab backing out, and then this part, whoopsie, that's not what I wanted to do. So this part, I don't know what I'm doing. But anyway, this part over here is the old exoskeleton that it's backing out of.
Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
Now we have one more little section to go over, which is reproduction, but we can kind of talk about that, I think, when we look at our crab.
Okay.
Because we only have about a little less than 10 minutes left. I wanna make sure that we go over the crab that you brought. So while Sandy is getting the crab ready, hold on, can we bring the questions back? Vera, in what zones of the ocean do the majority of arthropods reside? All over, because there's copepods everywhere. Crabs and lobsters are, you know, again, depending on the species, are gonna be different depths. Who are the barnacles' predators? I don't know that they really have any. What would eat barnacles?
Ooh, that's a good, I'm wondering if sea stars might eat barnacles.
Yeah, maybe sea stars might, I'm not sure. Sorry, Yaxiv, I don't know how to say your name. Why do barnacles attach themselves to whales? Because it's a free ride, and because they're filter feeding, the whale's moving through, and they get to constantly be filtering the food as they're passing by. Now, Sandy's still gonna finish this up, so while we're waiting for that, I do wanna go over the assignment with you. So we're gonna talk about the research paper really quick, the research proposal. So if I can pull the computer up, that would be fabulous. So when you download, there's actually an incorrect date. I deleted it off of this one. On Blackboard here, your due date is November 17th at 11:55 p.m. So this is the date that you need to go off of, and I will change it. I just uploaded it from last year, and the day was a different date last year. But basically, what you want to do for your research proposal is come up with an idea of something you want to know more about. This is not a research paper where you're just going to go look up sources and tell me about it. You're actually going to create a proposal. So down on the bottom here of all the criterion, there are 8 different topics you can write about. So for example, number 1, the effects of domoic acid poisoning on sea lions, pelicans, or fish. Now first, you have to get familiar with what is this even about. So you're gonna do some research to learn about it. Now hopefully by learning about the effects of domoic acid poisoning, you get an idea of something you want to know more about. So what you're gonna do is then create something to test. You're gonna create a research experiment. So you might say, how does domoic acid poisoning affect pelicans at different times of the year? That might be your question that you want to know more about. So you have to design an experiment to test that. How are you going to test that? What are you going to use? Now, this is a real thing. Like, for example, when you do a research proposal, the whole idea is I want to test something and I want to get funding for it. I want someone to help me get money to make this happen. So you have to write a proposal. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna get background on the topic, which I said you're gonna do research. Some of the prompts to help you with that is, what do I know about this topic? What research should I conduct to familiarize myself with the topic? Tell people why it's important. Why should we as humans care about this? Why do we want to study more about it? What else do you want to know? So this is your research question here, number 3. How are you going to test that question? So really spell out for me the entire process of what you're going to test and how you're going to test it. And then tell me where you're going to test it. So if you're going to test something, If you're going to test lionfish, you wouldn't do that in an area where there aren't lionfish. So identify the very specific area you want to do the study. On the second page, this is all the formatting questions. It walks you through the different sections that I want. You need to give me a title, an abstract, an introduction, tell me your hypothesis or the objective of your research, so why are you doing this, the methods and materials that you're going to use for your experiments, and then your literature cited. So I need to see where your sources are. Now there's very specific instructions for your introduction. For example, you need to include at least 4 references from 3 different sources. So you might be telling me about domoic acid in current research or previous research that's been done, and reference that research properly. All right, and then so take a look at this. Hopefully you're familiarized with that. There's also on here, there is there's an example. So make sure you take a look at that. This is an actual student's proposal, and this is exactly what I'm looking for. So read through this. If you want to get an A on the paper, I want to see something very similar to this. But this is not the topic you can choose because that's not one of the 8 that I put up there. So neener, neener, neener. But this will give you an idea of what we're looking at. All right, so with any questions on this, please email me. I'll touch base on this a little bit more again next week as well. Actually, no, next week I won't be here. It's going to be pre-recorded session, but please email me with all of that stuff. And in the last couple of minutes, we have about 5 minutes, we are going to pass it over to Sandy and tell us a little bit more about this crab that she brought here.
Yes, this is a local rock crab that I've just picked up at the seafood market. It is dead, so don't worry. It's not steamed yet, so this is its natural color. But just to show you, it is a true crab. It has 5 pairs of legs, and one of those pair are modified into the claws or the pincers. So this part is called the carapace. These are the legs, and then if we turn it over, we can see that it is female. Females and males differ by the shape of the abdomen. So remember we talked about the lobster before having that long abdomen? Well, crabs have the same body plan, but now this abdomen has been tucked under the body, under the carapace. So we're just going to open this up, and you can see that by this female has this U-shaped abdomen, and the male has a much thinner V-shaped abdomen. And if I lift up the abdomen, you can see underneath that there are all these furry appendages. Again, each segment has a pair of these appendages, and these particular appendages are called pereiopods, and they actually hold the eggs under the female's body. So if we look carefully, this might be hard to see, but there are 2 spots here under the abdomen on the thorax, and these are where the eggs are deposited from the female. She lays them onto these pereiopods, and from there she'll incubate them under her body and then release them by violently flapping this abdomen up and down when they're ready to be released.
Now, how do the eggs get fertilized?
The eggs get fertilized because the male inserts a sperm packet into the gonopores, which are these little openings here, and she'll store the sperm packet in her body until it's time for the eggs to be released. And as they're being released, then they're being passed by that sperm packet and they are fertilized.
And just remembering what we said about the abdomen here, right? We said that on a lobster, it's kind of straightened out, but on the crab, it's curved back up. Real quick, Gabriel had a question. Just to clarify, some lobsters are true crabs and some lobsters aren't, correct? So lobsters are their own section. The true crabs versus hermit crabs were the different types of crabs. Lobsters are their own thing.
Right.
How many points is the research proposal worth? 35. It's in your syllabus. All right, back to you, Sandy.
Okay, just real quick, I'm going to open this up. This is just how you would eat a crab.
Or maybe not.
This one's stuck. It's a big, strong one.
Oh, man, I cannot get in there. But basically, since we're running out of time, if you were to open this up, you would find the gills right here. So the crab breathes through the mouth here by sucking in water, passing it over its gills, and then expelling it through holes on the side by the base of its pincers. It has compound eyes, antenna.
Do they eat the crab? Would they eat crab pinchers as well as their meat in there?
Yes, there's meat in here as well as in the body. And if you're from the Chesapeake Bay like me, you know all about that.
All right. So thank you. I wish we would have spent a little bit more time.
Yes,
we didn't leave enough time for the crab there. That was our fault. But thank you, everyone, again. Great participation today. Don't forget your discussion board opens up, your quiz opens up, and your participation points are all open for today. And that'll all close by next Tuesday before class starts. Your extra credit is due tonight. Make sure it gets turned in. I don't want to hear that your internet didn't work or whatever. Think ahead. Make sure you get it all uploaded. Your midterm is coming up, which is going to be the first half of the class. Also, next week, don't forget that your paper is due, your actual assignment. Next week is pre-recorded, so there's not going to be any live components. Everything will be like the question of the day. Everything, all the participation points will be via the website. Email me if you have any questions. Thank you, Sandy.
Thank you, Kira.
And we'll see you next week.